Good afternoon and welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast on Project 4370, Controlling the Formation of Nitrosamine in Drinking Water Treatment. I am Jeanette Chiari. I am a research manager at the Water Research Foundation and I will be the moderator for today's webcast. Before we start, I would like to go through a few administrative items. First is that there will be a question and answer period after the presentation. So if during the presentation you have questions, please, you can enter them directly into the box at the lower left of the live studio screen. Also, at the end of the presentation, after the Q&A session, there will be few very short questions. Please take a time to answer them as we need your feedback on the webcast. Before we start the technical presentation, just a little bit of background about nitrosamines, a few known facts. We know that nitrosamines are carcinogens. For example, for NDMA, which is the most frequently detected nitrosamine in drinking water, a drinking water concentration of 0.7 nanogram per liter is associated with a 1 in a million lifetime excess cancer risk. In terms of occurrence, results from the UCMR2 show that NDMA and other nitrosamines are present in at least half of the U.S. chloraminated water system. We also know now that nitrosamines are disinfection byproducts of chloraminations, and precursors include, for example, amine-based polymers and anion exchange resins. Also, other precursors are wastewater content. In terms of regulations, right now, only California and Massachusetts have a 10 nanogram per liter public notification or regulatory level for NDMA and two other nitrosamines. Canada has a 40 nanogram per liter maximum acceptable concentrations for NDMA. Now, in terms of federal regulation, I have that on this slide, excerpts from last October preliminary regulatory determination notice, so I just took excerpts. So in short, what that says is that the US EPA has delayed the regulatory determination for nitrosamines, and this is mainly because, if you read through the text, that nitrosamines and also chlorates are DBPs, and because of risk-risk trade-off implication, the EPA has delayed the regulation as they will be evaluating them along with chlorate and other DBPs collectively as part of the next six-year review. And that's scheduled for later this year, 2015. Okay. NDMA and nitrosamine have been an important, we know that they are important to our drinking water utilities, especially the ones that use chloraminations. So the foundation has dedicated an entire focus area focused on NDMA and nitrosamines. And what I have here on this slide is a list of the ongoing projects that they cover: occurrence, treatment, precursors, and unintended consequences. So it's a very strong focus area for us. The last project, if you see at the end, I put in red, actually it is not a project yet. It has been just approved for funding by our Board of Trustees, and the RFP for this project will be released next week, March 27. So keep your eyes open. Okay, now we can go to this project, to the project 4370. We have three presenters today. We have a research team and the three part of the research team and presenters. Our research team, they have very extensive resume, and it would take hours if I needed to list all the accomplishments. For the sake of time, I will encourage you to look at their full bio, short bios in the webcast. To start, Dr. Paul Westerhoff, he's a professor at the School of Sustainable Engineering and the Built Environment and member of Civil Environment and Sustainable Engineering faculty at Arizona State University. He's currently the ASU Vice Provost for Academic Research. His research interests include, of course, DBPs, emerging contaminant in water, nanomaterial in water, and the use of nanomaterial-based technologies for water and reuse treatment. Short, very short bio. Our next presenter, who is a co-PI for this project, is Dr. Bill Mitch. He's an associate professor at the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at Stanford University. He has studied DBP's formation mechanism over the last 15 years with a particular interest in nitrosamine. And a new fact that he will serve as a vice chair for the next 2015 Disinfection Byproduct Gordon Conference. Our third presenter and the PI for this project is Stuart Krasner. Stuart Krasner is a principal environmental specialist at the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California. He has been working there for 38 years. Congratulations, Stuart. His area of expertise and research interest include disinfection byproducts of health and regulatory concern, pharmaceutical, personal care product, and wastewater impact on drinking water. And this is very short. Again, I told you, if you want the full bios, please look at the website. Okay, so now we are going to go to the next first presenter, who is Dr. Paul Westerhoff. Paul, your turn.
Thanks, Jeanette. So this is Paul Westerhoff. I'm going to start off today's webinar describing some of the project objectives and some of our first steps in terms of lab work. But first, I want to start with the overall project objectives. As listed here, there are three of them, really, but to evaluate and develop low-cost, effective strategies for minimizing nitrosamine formation during drinking water while keeping other regulatory and operational requirements in place, and to develop some treatment guidance for utilities. So overall, these objectives were organized into six tasks, as shown here. We're going to focus today, myself and Bill, in that yellow zone of tasks 2 through 5, and then Stuart, the PI of the project, at the end is going to kind of integrate those laboratory studies and look at them from a case study of full-scale treatment plants. So then the outline for today is I'm going to talk first about some of the major sources of NDMA precursors, and specifically the role of cationic polymers and how to physically remove these precursors through adsorption. Then Bill Mitch is going to look at oxidation of the precursors to destroy them, and the relationships he's developed between CT and that transformation of the precursors. And then Stuart's going to integrate these findings that we see at full-scale facilities, which use multiple treatment processes in series. So what I'd like to do is to first summarize a table that we put together for a State of the Science report amongst our team here, and that looked at the relative importance of precursors for drinking water and their potential to form nitrosodimethylamine. So this is based upon a literature review, and it's a few years old, and the exact order of some of these may have changed a little bit over the past year or two, but the general order is along the lines of what Jeanette mentioned earlier, that the top two are probably being downstream of, say, treated wastewater discharges into a surface water, effluent-impacted waters, and the use of certain polymeric amine-based cationic polymers, which are used during coagulation to both enhance coagulation, to get good settling, and then also to have good filterability of the water. And then some of the specific pharmaceuticals and personal care products in wastewater have also been identified as precursors. And then down through the list, we have at the bottom kind of natural sources of algae or bulk dissolved organic nitrogen. And this might be different if you have, say, microbially or biologically active filters. These might become more important if you don't have, say, a wastewater impacted upstream. So there's both natural sources, wastewater drive sources, and kind of in-plant sources. To give some sense of these, here's one example from our project that correlates the potential for nitrosodimethylamine, NDMA, FP is the formation potential. This is a laboratory measurement. If you have a water sample, you chloraminate it at a fairly high chloramine dose and hold it for about 3 days at room temperature. And here it's correlated to sucralose for as a site-specific wastewater tracer. And sucralose is a chlorinated sugar. It's in, maybe you just had it over lunch in your diet soda, but it goes through wastewater treatment plants fairly unmetabolized and into surface waters where it stays quite stable. And so if you plotted this versus, say, flow in a river compared to the flow of a wastewater treatment plant, sucralose is really a tracer indicator of wastewater origin. And we see that higher sucralose results in a water that has raw drinking water that has higher NDMA formation potential. Now, sucralose itself is not a precursor for NDMA. It's just a source tracer. But it shows the importance of, say, wastewater or derived organics as a source of NDMA precursors. So what I'd like to do now is start talking about some of the laboratory work we've been doing. And first, to look at one of the important classes of precursor material, and that's polydadmac or cationic polymers. And so we investigated these in jar tests. And here we conducted jar tests with both deionized water or ultra-pure water, as well as Central Arizona Project water. This is Colorado River water. And here on the x-axis, we have the first six polymers are all cationic polymers that we obtained from various utilities. And the one on the far right, the CC2220, is a polyamine polymer. We added alum, about 50 milligrams per liter, during the Colorado River jar test, coagulated the water, let it settle, and then we analyzed nitrosodimethylamine NDMA FP yield in the supernatant. And so we did this again with both water sources. And if we look at the green bars first, there's quite a low variability in terms of different sources of the first six, seven polydadmac polymers between 100 and 200 nanograms per liter of NDMA formed per milligram of active polymer. So it really didn't matter the source of the material, the source of the polymer, it behaved similarly. Now, if we look at the orange bars, this was in the Colorado River water with alum, there's about a half to a third the amount of NDMA, or somewhere around 30 to 50 nanograms per liter per milligram of active polymer. So what we found in all these is that a small polymer residual was not able to be removed from solution, and upon chloramination, that formed NDMA. The one on the far right is a polyamine that formed about the similar amount as the polydadmac in the Colorado River water, although a little bit higher in the distilled water. And so this figure and a few of the other figures are from a AWWA journal that we recently published. So what this work shows is that the cationic polymer forms NDMA or contributes as an NDMA-derived precursor. Now, what we wanted to do is to understand what happens at a water treatment plant if these polymers are stored for a long time, because in the literature, there was some thinking that older or aged polymers were going to potentially break down this high molecular weight polymer into smaller pieces that could form NDMA. So here, this was just one polymer, but we did this for several of those from the previous slide. On the y-axis, again, is this NDMA yield per milligram of active polymer. And we see that initially as received, or whether we aged it for a month at any of these temperatures, there was no significant difference in the amount of NDMA formation potential. Or really, we're saying that the polymers do not break down in such a way that would affect NDMA formation later on. So that was good news. So what we found then in this first part is that these implant-derived precursors, specifically the cationic polydadmac, really contributed to NDMA. And we've done a number of different experiments that showed even very low polymer doses, we would have a small contribution to NDMA potentially later on. And the more polymer you put in at the bench scale, we always formed more NDMA formation potential after coagulation in the settled water. Now, we also know that NDMA can form during chloramination of these wastewater-derived precursors. There's some thought whether these are specific trace organics. People have looked at various personal care products or pharmaceuticals themselves. But the background natural organic matter in a river that's not impacted tends to have a lot less NDMA compared to the organic matter coming out of wastewater treatment plants. So when we were looking at the removal of these precursors, we were interested in these two classes of precursors as we go through the next set of slides here. So first, if we look at implant removal of precursors, we really found that alum and ferric coagulation alone did a very poor job at removing these wastewater-derived precursors, whether they're natural NOM type of materials or of wastewater origin. And this is consistent with our understanding that these precursors, things like pharmaceuticals, are not very well removed during simple coagulation. When we did coagulation with a metal salt plus a cationic polymer, we saw some removal of the watershed precursors as what was coming in the source water, and a little bit of addition of cationic polymer-derived precursors. So you remove some, but you add some. So there's a little bit of trade-off that goes on there. Then next, I'll talk about activated carbon, both powder and granular activated carbon, on its ability to absorb or physically remove these precursors. So activated carbon will absorb small, low molecular weight materials very well. And we evaluated its potential both by powder activated carbon, or PAC, and then packed beds of granular activated carbon. And here it summarizes how we measured this NDMA formation potential after 3 days in these next set of experiments. So here what we're showing is that on the x-axis is powder activated carbon dose. So initially, we went up to outrageously high doses of 210 milligrams per liter. We just didn't know what we were going to need. And on the y-axis is the NDMA formation potential that remains after exposure to powder activated carbon. And here what we saw is even at a powder activated carbon dose that's reasonable of 15 milligrams per liter, we have 30% remaining, or 70% removal of these wastewater-derived precursors. So this experiment was conducted with secondary effluent. And we can keep adding powder activated carbon somewhere between 75 and 100 milligrams per liter. We really don't incrementally remove anymore. So it suggests that there's a fraction that's fairly well removed of these precursors and a fraction that may not be removed, although that other fraction is fairly small, may only contribute 5 or 10% to the NDMA later on. So then what we wanted to do is to look at more reasonable powder activated carbon doses as shown here, 3, 8, and then one high dose of 75, just to look at an extreme case of potential removal. Here we looked at two different types of powder activated carbon. This again is a water source that's impacted by wastewater. And what we saw is that there's a difference between the two carbon types. We're not saying one is always better than the other, but just like the use of powder activated carbon to remove MIB or geosmin in a certain water source, one carbon might perform better than the other. But we can see is even at a powder activated carbon dose of 3 milligrams per liter, this Calgon WPH removed about 40% of the NDMA precursors, and at 8 milligrams per liter removed 60% of the precursors. So higher PAC doses leads to better removal. But again, even these low powder activated carbon doses, if you optimize the carbon type, you can remove quite a bit of these watershed-derived precursors. So now, in contrast to that, we also looked at the ability of powder activated carbon to remove that residual polymer in the presence of cationic polymer during coagulation. So here, this is simply putting the polydadmac into ultra-pure water, deionized water, DI water, three different polydadmac doses on the x-axis going up to very high doses, and then three different powder activated or zero powder activated carbon and two powder activated carbon doses. And then we have here the NDMA formation potential in nanograms per liter. So what we see is that as we add more polymer in these white bars, the amount of NDMA formation always went up. And as we added powder activated carbon at the same time, we got really very little removal, if any, of these polymer-derived NDMA precursors. So what this suggests or shows is that the polymer-derived precursors cannot be well removed by powder activated carbon. And so it's in stark contrast to our ability to remove the kind of wastewater or watershed-derived precursors by powder activated carbon. So we've, in our AWWA paper, we've looked at simulating these trade-offs of adding different amounts or different types of polymers and then adding different types of powder activated carbon. So you might start with a water, say, of 15 nanograms per liter. But if you add polymer, it would increase. The activated carbon will remove the watershed precursors, but not your NDMA. And so from your polymer. So there's always going to be a trade-off between what you can remove and how much you're adding in terms of the polymers. So now I'd like to show just a few slides. That was with powder activated carbon. Now if we look at packed beds, we did these in columns in the lab using granular activated carbon. Here, what we're looking at is the breakthrough up to 10,000 bed volumes of four different columns, and on the y-axis, NDMA formation potential. We have two different types of granular activated carbon, and then we have different blends. The top one here is 10% wastewater, 90% Colorado River water. The next two different types of carbon, 50% wastewater, and the last one, 90% wastewater. So you can see that we have the fastest breakthrough of the NDMA precursors in the highest wastewater that has the most precursors in it. But we get very good removal of these precursors overall. And to show kind of a comparison of these breakthrough curves compared to the breakthrough of dissolved organic carbon on this, or DOC, and UV absorbance at 254 nanometers, compared to the NDMA formation potential here on a normalized basis to what's going on to the columns, you see that our ability to remove these NDMA formation potential precursors are better than our ability to remove UV or DOC. And this is important because we know that UV-254 is a very good indicator for our potential to remove PHM precursors. So here we can remove these NDMA precursors much better than we can remove THM precursors. So this suggests that granular activated carbon in a watershed that has high levels of precursors might provide quite a bit of a benefit. So we've also done experiments where we simply apply polymer-derived material onto granular activated carbon. And it's a little difficult to see from this graph, but what we saw is in the gray, really zero NDMA coming out of the column. So we didn't form NDMA in the column. And our NDMA precursors were roughly the same as what went into the column. So this is kind of like the powder activated carbon with the polymer derived materials, that activated carbon does a poor job at removing those precursors, but it does a good job at removing the NDMA precursors that are present in the watershed. And that really draws me to the summary of this physical removal side and a little bit of an explanation of between the differences of these wastewater-derived organics, which really behave like trace organics at a nanogram per liter level that contribute to nanogram per liter levels of NDMA. Polymer, really in the jar test, any polymer dose always contributed towards NDMA, and it was always a balancing between removing the wastewater or watershed precursors compared to the amount of NDMA we're adding by the polymers. Alum coagulation alone did not remove any of the watershed precursors, really low doses of powder activated carbon can remove pretty high levels of percentages of the wastewater precursors. And likewise, granular activated carbon remove NDMA precursors well, and to an extent that's better than their removal potential of THM and HAA precursors. So thanks for that time. I'm going to hand it over to Bill Mitch now to talk about oxidative treatments for nitrosamine control.
Great. Thank you, Paul. So like Paul said, we'll be looking at oxidative treatments and specifically how can the application of oxidants or also UV light deactivate precursors before you apply chloramines. So just for a little bit of background, people are looking for new applying new disinfectant combinations to meet the new DBP rules and help control the formation of THMs and HAAs. But unfortunately, each disinfectant is associated with the formation of different byproducts. So we know that chlorine forms trihalomethanes and haloacetic acids, as well as a whole range of other halogenated DBPs. Ozone helps promote the formation of bromate and certain other halogenated DBPs like chloropicrin. Chlorine dioxide is associated with the formation of chlorite. And medium pressure UV is also associated with the formation of chloropicrin. And the reason why we're on the phone here today is essentially because chloramines are associated with the formation of nitrosamines. So it might be difficult to find any specific magic bullet disinfectant that's going to solve all the DBP problems. It might become more of an optimization problem. And so in a previous project, 4180, we had specifically looked at some of the trade-offs that happen as you increase for different preoxidant treatments, so chlorine, medium pressure UV, ozone, or chlorine dioxide. As you increase that disinfectant exposure, we should see deactivation of NDMA formation because we're deactivating the precursors when we follow it with chloramines. But also, as we increase that exposure, there's trade-offs involved because you start forming some other unwanted byproducts. So here's just an example from one of the utilities we looked at, a wastewater impacted utility, where, for example, in the upper left, you see chlorine, and we're applying different levels of chlorine exposure, milligrams minutes per liter. And in the blue diamonds, you see the level of NDMA goes down as you increase that pre-chlorine exposure when we follow that chlorine treatment with chloramines. But as we increase that exposure, we're unfortunately also promoting the formation of, in the red squares, THMs, and in the green triangles, haloacetic acids. Similarly, if you look on the upper right, you can see medium pressure UV, where again NDMA in all these plots is after chloramination is shown in the blue diamonds. And we can see that increasing UV fluence with medium pressure UV is associated with a reduction in NDMA formation. But unfortunately, you start to promote the formation of chloropicrin, trichloronitromethane, in the red squares. With ozone, NDMA declines with exposure, but we start promoting in the green triangles bromate, and in the red squares, trichloronitromethane or chloropicrin. And lastly, with chlorine dioxide, we reduce NDMA formation, but the unfortunate outcome is we also increase the final concentration of chlorite. So that was an example of some of the trade-offs we looked at in a previous project, and a portion of this project was of the 4370 project was to try to nail down some details. The previous project was more of a broader survey and also trying to analyze some of these trade-off issues, and here we wanted to understand some of the deactivation issues in greater depth. So sort of a summary of the trade-off concept is that obviously we're applying disinfectants to control pathogens and the acute risk. Previously, we'd worried about the formation of regulated byproducts such as trihalomethanes and haloacetic acids, but now it's really a sort of a three-point optimization scheme where we're also looking to control the formation of emerging byproducts, including nitrosamines, as well as potentially other NDBPs. So just a little background on how we do these experiments, the pre-oxidation experiments. And what we did in the 4370 project was to apply what we call either a low or a high exposure of the different oxidants at exposures that we considered potentially relevant to drinking water treatment. And so just a background, how we're calculating exposure is measuring the disinfectant residual concentrations, for example, in the case of chlorine over time, and integrating under the curve. So it's the integral under the residual concentration versus time curve. And for ozone, and we used 0.2 to 1 milligrams minutes per liter. For chlorine, it was 14 or 60 milligrams minutes per liter. And we chose these levels as levels relevant to Giardia kill. So we're trying to hit exposures that were relevant to drinking water disinfection. In the case of UV treatment, in the previous project, we'd mostly focused on medium pressure UV treatment. For this project, we wanted to compare medium pressure and low pressure UV treatment. And the fluents that we applied as average germicidal fluents, so the energy actually experienced on average by the water within the germicidal range, we chose 186 millijoules per centimeter squared as a level somewhat relevant to disinfection, but also a much higher fluence, 1,000, that was more relevant to advanced oxidation processes. And lastly, we found out in the previous project that chlorine dioxide was not one of the more effective pre-oxidant treatments, but there was some previous research that suggested that maybe permanganate might be relevant. So we also evaluated two exposures, 10 and 25 milligrams minutes per liter with permanganate. And we did this by applying a 1 milligram per liter dose for various times. The 1 milligram per liter dose was the dose at which you start to see a pink residual color in the water. So we figured that would be a sort of upper limit dose to what might be employed in practice. So we apply these pre-oxidants for those exposures, but then we follow it by a chloramination technique that's different from what Paul was talking about before. So Paul had been applying formation potential conditions, which tend to involve a relatively high chloramine dose for an extended time. For uniform formation conditions, we were trying to hit chloramine conditions relevant to drinking water practice. And so what we applied was 2.5 milligrams per liter of chloramines formed by mixing chlorine and ammonia in about a 4.75 to 1 rate ratio. And so the additional details was we kept the pH at 8 and for about a 3-day contact time. We looked at a variety of waters, including about 10 different utilities, generally sampled as far into the plant as we could go before disinfectants were applied. To give you some details, we looked at 6 wastewater impacted plants, an additional 4 wastewater impacted plants that also used polydadmac, 2 plants that used polyamines or 2 waters actually that used polyamine coagulants. And lastly, 2 wastewater treatment plant effluents. DADMAC dosages on a median level were 0.4 milligrams per liter as polymer. So we always refer to it as polymer, where many of the polydadmac stocks are about 20% active ingredient. To give you a range of how much NDMA forms under uniform formation conditions, so this chloramination condition relevant to drinking water practice. Without any pre-oxidation treatment, on a median level, we were forming about 38 nanograms per liter with a range of 9 to 58. So first thing we wanted to do was to compare across the different waters the relative efficacy of these different pre-oxidation treatments. And so what you see on the left is NDMA, the initial concentration, if you applied no pre-oxid, or the C over C naught, where C is the concentration after you apply or expose the water to a pre-oxidant, and C naught is if you just applied chloramines alone. And so we looked for each oxidant at the low and high pretreatment exposures we talked about previously. And so what we see is that ozone tends to be the most effective. So even at its low exposure, you're getting a dramatic reduction in NDMA formation ability. So down on a median level at about 75% reduction, for example. Fluorine and medium pressure UV were somewhat similar. But interestingly, if we compare medium pressure UV and low pressure UV for the same applied fluents, low pressure UV tended to be less effective than medium pressure UV. We looked at fewer waters with permanganate because it didn't seem very promising with the few waters we looked at, but it seems to be a similar story to what we'd seen earlier with chlorine dioxide, that it doesn't tend to be very effective for NDMA removal. One of the things we wanted to look at was the previous chart was summarizing all the data from the different types of water, and we wanted to see to what extent is the story similar for different types of impacts. So we're showing that here for various different waters, where WW refers to waters that are only wastewater impacted, and WWPD refers to plants that have wastewater impacted source waters but also use polydadmac in the treatment plant. And the general idea is you don't see dramatic differences between whether you're applying chlorine, ozone, or medium pressure UV, regardless of the exposure level. So you tend to have similar impacts for those two types of scenarios. One of the questions we had is ozone and medium pressure UV can effectively deactivate NDMA precursors, but the mechanism wasn't quite clear. And so we wanted to begin to figure out those processes. And in both cases, they can potentially act directly. So ozone itself can oxidize various organic molecules, and UV light can lead to direct photolysis of certain chemicals. But both also have indirect processes as well. So as ozone degrades, it produces hydroxyl radical, and light itself can generate indirect photochemical processes, including the production of hydroxyl radical. And so one of the things we did was to apply tert-butanol, which is a scavenger of hydroxyl radical, and to see whether it made a difference. And so what we tend to see with both ozone and UV treatment is that even if we add tert-butanol, which would be the yellow bars, we don't see a dramatic difference from conditions where we don't apply tert-butanol, such as in the red bar. So hydroxyl radical doesn't appear to be important in either case. And why this might be somewhat relevant is because alkalinity in water, carbonates, can be effective hydroxyl radical scavengers. And so if you had a high alkalinity water and hydroxyl radical was important to this deactivation process, you might expect that you wouldn't have effective deactivation. But it seems that that's not necessarily the case. However, what we do see with medium pressure UV is an interesting correlation. So if you look at the right-hand side chart, we see that as you increase the DOC content of your water, you get increasing deactivation of NDMA formation, which tends to suggest that there is an indirect photochemical process going on. So the more organic matter you have, the more likely the organic matter is absorbing the UV light, leading to the production of something, maybe not hydroxyl radical, but something else that can deactivate your NDMA precursors. We did correlations with the various wavelengths associated with UV light, and the highest correlations, not necessarily the best correlations in the world, but somewhat higher correlations were observed for the lower wavelengths, emission wavelengths of the medium pressure lamps seen down at the bottom. We also wanted to look at the role of temperature. And so if you look at the legend in the center, what we did was essentially vary the temperatures for both the pre-oxidation exposure as well as the post-chloramination steps. And we tried the four different combinations you can see below for chlorine, ozone, and medium pressure UV treatment. And just to summarize, with chlorine, which is the chart on the left, we see the highest formation when we chlorinate, do the chlorine treatment under cold conditions, and then follow it by treatment with chloramines under warm conditions. Those are the green bars. But if we were to actually compare, so that's suggesting that as you chill the solution and you're applying chlorine, the chlorine reacts more slowly, so you're deactivating less effectively. But as you warm up the water during chloramination, you get effective NDMA, faster NDMA formation. What probably matters in practice is whether you get greater formation in the winter or the summer. So the winter-like conditions would be represented by the yellow bars, where both the chlorine and the chloramine treatment was conducted under cold conditions, and the summer would be when they were both warm, which are the red bars. And so what we tend to see for chlorine is higher formation in the winter. So it appears that the more temperature-sensitive step is the chlorine pre-oxidation step. Ozone, we see that warm temperature for chloramination tended to be the most important step. So one would expect that you get higher formation during the summer, which is sort of borne out by the red bars as compared to the yellow winter-like conditions. For medium pressure UV, it seems to depend on the water. So both steps might be temperature sensitive, and it's somewhat depends on the specific water in a way that we can't yet predict. Another thing we wanted to look at was, are there ways that we can alter the chloramination process, so rather than just applying preoxidants, alter the way that we chloraminate to reduce NDMA formation? And so the general idea here is that when you form chloramines, if you're applying chlorine to after the ammonia is already present, so if we think of the cartoon on the right, you have chlorine molecules entering a well-mixed ammonia solution, you may be applying them under conditions where you would expect that you'd have predominantly monochloramine, but the chloramine formation reactions are very fast. So if you have a high concentration chlorine injection point, you can promote the formation of low amounts of dichloramine. But on the left, if we look at how NDMA is believed to form, dichloramine tends to be the predominant reagent. So is there a way that instead of applying chlorine to an ammonia-containing water, we can apply preformed monochloramine to avoid dichloramine formation, form the chloramines under conditions that minimize dichloramine? And so this might be relevant to waters that have ammonia present in their source water who might chlorinate and form chloramines in situ. Just as an example where this frequently occurs is potable reuse scenarios. And so an example of such a treatment train is provided in the chart below, where we have secondary wastewater effluent that might contain ammonia. Oftentimes upstream of RO membranes, they apply ozone and potentially right before the microfilters also chloramines to control biofouling on RO membranes. And in the bars, as we follow this treatment train, what we see is in the pink is NDMA, but we also looked at a variety of other nitrosamines present in this wastewater, including total nitrosamines shown by the upper, the length of the full bar. What we see is we get a dramatic increase in total nitrosamines due to both ozonation and due to the chloramination in the microfilter, and then it goes away as we run it through RO and advanced oxidation. So the problem is that some of these other oxidants, like ozone, might promote the formation of nitrosamines. So is there a better way? So one of the things we were looking at is, can we focus instead on something like medium pressure UV, which can, the UV light itself will destroy nitrosamines, but as we've seen before, it can also deactivate nitrosamine precursors, and couple that with the formation of preformed monochloramine to avoid the formation of dichloramine when people inject chlorine into an ammonia-containing water. And so we looked at three examples, water 3 on the left in the lower left figure, is an ammonia-containing drinking water treatment plant. So it has ammonia in their source water. And on waters 9 and 10 were actual wastewater effluents that both contain different levels of ammonia. And so what we see looking at the wastewaters that had NDMA in the influent, shown by the white bars, as we apply medium pressure UV, you degrade NDMA as expected. if we apply chlorine to this ammonia-containing wastewater, we begin to form some dichloramine. So in the blue bar, you see substantial increases in NDMA concentration. If we combine medium pressure with conventional way of chloraminating, we do get a reduction due to the UV treatment, as shown in the red. If we apply preformed chloramines, looking at, say, water 3 on the left compared to conventional treatment in the blue bar, if we apply preformed chloramines, we get a substantial reduction. And if we combine the two treatments, so apply medium pressure UV as well as preformed chloramines, compared to the blue bar and the green bar, we get about a 90% reduction in NDMA formation. An alternative, if you have an ammonia-containing water, is to try to go through breakpoint chlorination. So if you look at the chart on the right, we see that we could apply preformed chloramines, so that's the option at the far left, or we could start increasing our chlorine dose until we exceed the breakpoint for various points of time, and those are different free chlorine exposures we've achieved on the right three labels, so 4 milligrams per minute liter of free chlorine all the way up to 225. So if you exceed and go through the breakpoint, you can reduce your NDMA formation shown in the red compared to the addition of preformed chloramines on the far left, but at the unfortunate trade-off that you're also promoting the formation of other unwanted byproducts such as THMs, dichloroacetonitrile, and halogenated aldehydes. And so just an overall summary, comparing the different free oxidants, ozone tended to be the most efficient with the proviso that if you apply this to actual wastewater effluents, ozone can sometimes directly form substantial levels of NDMA. We don't tend to see this in wastewater-impacted drinking water plants, but for potable reuse scenarios, it can be problematic. Water's impacted by into different extents by wastewater or wastewater polydadmac tended to have similar behaviors. Chlorine and medium pressure UV were somewhat similarly efficient, although somewhat less efficient than ozone. Interestingly, low pressure UV was less effective than medium pressure UV. And the UV mechanism seems to involve an indirect photochemical process, although not hydroxyl radical based. There are some seasonal issues where winter conditions would be expected to, if you're using free chlorine as a preoxidant, would be expected to promote NDMA formation. For ozone, you expect higher formation during the summer and variable levels for medium pressure UV. And I put in the proviso there, if all else is equal, because you can get variations in your source water quality in terms of precursor concentrations seasonally as well. And lastly, for source waters that do have ammonia in them, there might be an effective combination might be a combination of medium pressure UV pretreatment along with preformed monochloramine as a combination to reduce your formation. And I'd like to then hand it off to Stuart.
Hello. Today I'll be talking about case studies on nitrosamine formation and control at full-scale drinking water plants. And I'd like to thank the drinking water plants that participated in this study. The objective was to conduct case studies at plants in both the U.S. and a part of Canada and determine precursor loadings in the water from using formation potential tests. Also, we looked at the fate and control of the precursors through treatment using formation potential tests. And then finally, we looked at the impact of water quality and operations on nitrosamine formation, doing a combination of full-scale monitoring and simulated distribution system tests. And I'll give an example of some SDS results later. This just gives you a visual of our experimental. At the top, when we wanted to determine the occurrence of nitrosamines, we looked at what was coming into the plant and what was leaving and sampled in the distribution system. Then at the bottom, we wanted to look at the sources of precursors and their removal using formation potential test. So we would not only run a formation potential test on the raw water in the plant influent, but we'd run a sample of the settled water to see if polymer usage increased precursor loading. Then for processes that could destroy or remove precursors, we measured formation potential before and after that process. So for example, before and after ozone, before and after powdered or granular activated carbon. Okay, the first example I'd like to give you is a summary of the impact of polymer. And again, to remind you, we took the formation potential of the settled water, compared it to the plant influent, and we looked to see if there was an increase or decrease in the formation potential. So in this next plot, I show a summary of the plants that use polydadmac on the left, the one plant that we sampled twice that used polyamine in the middle, and then on the right, other plants that either didn't use polymer or in one case used a low dose of polyacrylamide. And this just gives you box and whisker plots, the box, the 25th to 75th percentile occurrence, the whisker to the 10th to 90th percentile occurrence. So we look on the right, the other plants that either didn't use a polymer or a low dose of polyacrylamide in general had little or no impact on the formation potential and perhaps removed a little of the precursors. If we look on the left side for the plants that used polydadmac, we see in general that the use of polydadmac resulted in the formation potential of the settled water being so many milligrams per liter higher, nanograms per liter higher in formation potential than the raw water. When we look at the plants that used polyamine, we only have two bits of data, but they had 15 nanograms per liter more formation potential in the settled water. Now, I should point out, on an active polymer dose, there was more polyamine used at those plants than the polydadmac plant, so that may have contributed. But it does show either polydadmac or polyamine could increase the formation potential of the water. Now let's look at the impact of powdered and granular carbon, and Paul showed you results earlier at bench scale. We'll now show you full scale data. This first plant had a reservoir at the beginning of the plant in which they applied powdered activated carbon, but no coagulants. And this was basically to remove taste and odor causing chemicals. And they had two events, one with 6 milligrams of powdered carbon used and the other with 12 milligrams of carbon. Then the next unit process was conventional treatment, and we sampled the said basin effluent to look at the impact of coagulation. And they were not using polymer during these sample events. Now, first looking at the reservoir effluent, you'll see in the red bar that the powdered activated carbon removed about 40 to 60% of the NDMA precursors, and that the removal of NDMA precursors was better than the removal of the bulk organic carbon, where the removal of TOC is in blue. So again, similar to what we saw in the bench scale work. Now, if we go to the said basin effluent, we see that conventional treatment had little or no impact on the NDMA precursors. And in the 12 milligram per liter PAC event, that negative removal is actually just experimental error. And basically, the NDMA formation potential was essentially the same before and after conventional treatment, whereas conventional treatment naturally can remove TOC and UV. So it's showing that the process where you can remove the precursors was not conventional treatment, but the use of the powdered activated carbon. Okay, now we'll move to a plant that had GAC at full scale. What we did was we sampled different GAC contactors that had been in service for different amounts of time, looking at generating somewhat similar to what Paul had generated at bench scale of a breakthrough curve. Now in red, we show the breakthrough for the total organic carbon, and after the carbon had been in service for quite a while, we were up to about 80% breakthrough. But when we look at blue for the NDMA precursors, we see that we're still getting good precursor removal, even at a point in which the bulk organic carbon has had high breakthrough. And I should mention, this plant, based on sucralose, was wastewater impacted, and they had a polydadmac dose of 0.2 milligrams per liter. But when we did our formation potential testing, most of the precursors were watershed-derived, not polymer-derived, and this plant operated with an empty bed contact time of 21 minutes. Okay, the next plant that we looked at was not wastewater impacted based on sucralose, although they did have some watershed-derived precursors. This plant used four times as much polydadmac, and the 0.8 milligram per liter dose is as the active ingredient, not as the polymer solution. And this plant had an EBCT of only 10 minutes. The important thing to see is if you look at the blue points, which represent the NDMA formation potential, sometimes we saw some removal, but most of the time we had poor removal of NDMA precursors. And again, this plant had a combination of polymer-derived precursors and watershed-derived precursors, but they weren't specifically wastewater-derived precursors. So this is showing the importance of what type of precursor source you have, how effective the activated carbon may be. Now let's look at a process that we didn't study at bench scale, but we did look at in our full-scale study, and that's the impact of riverbank filtration. And this has been looked at in a previous Research Foundation project in Europe, and there are some plants in the States that also have riverbank filtration. In this particular plant, the travel time from the river to the riverbank filter well was about 21 to 90 days. So what we did was we sampled the water at riverbank filtration well about a month after we sampled the river water to try to follow a plug of water. Now, what you see in riverbank filtration is what is referred to as an overall removal, which is a combination of the true removal through riverbank filtration plus dilution with local groundwater. So in this first slide, we're looking at the overall removal of the bulk organic carbon, the UV-254, and NDMA precursors. And we did this twice in 2012 and twice in 2013. And in all events, we were getting very high removal of NDMA precursors. And as I mentioned, part of it is due to true removal through the riverbank, and part of it is due to dilution with local groundwater. But we're seeing more removal of NDMA precursors than the bulk organic matter. So now let's look at true removal, and this is where we then correct for dilution with groundwater. And what we see was about 60% of the NDMA precursors were removed through the riverbank, and this was likely due to a combination of biodegradation and sorption. And the removal of NDMA precursors was higher than that of the bulk organic matter. Okay, now we'll look at the impact of ozone. Now, unlike what Bill showed in his bench scale experiments where he controlled CT and pH, we were collecting data at plants that are using ozone for a variety of purposes, from taste and odor to disinfection. So we saw plants that had CT from 0.1 to 8.6, where on a median basis it was 1.2, which was about what Bill had for what he called high exposure. The pH ranged from 6.6 to 8.8, but on a median basis it was close to neutral. Okay, this is a summary of all of the plants, and what you can see is with ozone being installed for purposes other than NDMA precursor removal, we are getting a range of precursor destruction with ozone on a median basis about 40%, and the 75th percentile was about 60%. Now, I looked at the top two data points, which were 74 to 89% of precursor destruction. This was at a plant that was ozonating softened water. Their CT was about 1, which was the median CT for all the plants in the study, but their pH was 8 to 9, And as I mentioned in the study, the median pH was 7.3. And one of the things is what is best to deactivate are deprotonated amines. And you get deprotonated amines at a high pH. So that suggests why the ozone was most effective at this plant, because of there being at a higher pH. Other than that, there was no good explanation for the other data, because we had a concurrence of different things happening, changes in CT, pH, changes in precursor source. Now let's look at the impact of prechlorination. What we did was we looked at free chlorine contact time, and Bill in his presentation focused on low and high exposure, but here I'll just focus on low, medium, and high free chlorine contact times. What I've done is split it into three groups. The first group on the left had very short free chlorine contact times, 0 to 3 minutes, on a median basis only 1.3 minutes. The group in the middle had moderate free chlorine contact times. The median level was 19 minutes. And then the group on the right had high free chlorine contact times all over an hour. If we look first at the group with short free chlorine contact times, we have a range of NDMA formation. And this now is actual formation in the distribution system. But if we look at the other two groups, medium and high free chlorine contact time, other than an outlier in each case, there was very little NDMA formation. And for those two groups, the median formation was either a little over 2 nanograms per liter or less than 2 nanograms per liter, where our minimum reporting level is 2. So it's showing with long free chlorine contact times or high exposure, you can be very efficient at destroying precursors, and during post-chloramination will result in very little NDMA formation. However, as Bill pointed out, you'll naturally be forming more trihalomethanes during the longer free chlorine contact time. So this is an issue that has to be looked at, balancing the formation of regulated byproducts with an emerging byproduct. Now, moving on a little bit to look at the impact of pH, oxidants such as hypochlorous acid react with deprotonated amines, and the question is, where is the best place to be pH-wise? Well, hypochlorous acid is a better oxidant than hypochlorite ion, and the pKa for hypochlorous acid is 7.5. If you look at the pKa of trimethylamine, which is a good example of an amine, it's at 9.8. As I mentioned, you have to be at high pH to get deprotonated amines. So the best place to be is halfway between the two pKa's. That's where you'll have sufficient hypochlorous acid and sufficient deprotonated amines to destroy some of your precursors. So that average value will be at about 8.6, assuming that your amines are all trimethylamine. Now, what we've done here is some bench scale simulated distribution system testing where we collected water from a plant and we first tried to simulate the way the plant operated. And that plant chlorinated the water for 1.7 minutes at pH 6.8 and then added ammonia. When we did that test at bench, we saw about 12 nanograms per liter of NDMA formed, which was very close to what the full-scale plants on their distribution system. We then did several experiments. We first held the water at this low pH of 6.8 and increased the free chlorine contact time to 5 and 10 minutes. And even though we're at a low pH, with higher free chlorine contact time, we were able to decrease NDMA formation during post-chloramination and brought it down from 12 to 2 nanograms per liter. The other thing we did was kept the water at a short free chlorine contact time of 1.7 minutes, but instead raised the pH from 6.8 to 7.3 to 7.8. And what we saw was at the higher pH, we saw less NDMA formation, again, because we were at a more effective pH to destroy the deprotonated amines. So this shows with a bench scale test, we came up with two different options that the plant could do full scale depending on their infrastructure and operations, which would be the process that might be the more effective for them to use. So in summary, in our full-scale studies, we showed that polydadmac and polyamine were important sources of NDMA precursors, that the use of powdered carbon, granular activated carbon, or riverbank filtration could remove watershed-derived NDMA precursors, whereas the plant that used GAC and was dominated by polydadmac precursors did not have effective removal of NDMA precursors. We also saw that ozone and chlorine destroyed NDMA precursors, and prechlorine was impacted by contact time and pH. And for pre-ozone, one factor that could impact the effectiveness is the pH at which ozonation is occurring. And now I'll turn it back to Jeanette.
Thank you, Stuart. Great presentation. Thank you all. Before we go to the Q&A period, I'm announced that the Water Research Foundation is co-sponsoring the Gordon Research Conference. The Gordon Research Conference on DVPs. This is probably the best conference on DVPs. It has the most updated and up-to-date information on DVPs. So please visit the GWRC, the GRC website. And actually, our three presenters will be presenting at this conference. It's really worth visiting. Thank you. So now, we can go to questions. The first question, I'm not going to leave to let Stu breathe. See, the first question, I'm sorry, it's like it just disappeared from my screen. So I suppose it is addressed to Stuart because it was during his presentation. When performing the NDMA FP test, did you always use chloramines? Please clarify that chlorine as the final disinfectant will produce NDMA in the distribution system.
Okay, when we do the formation potential test, always use chloramines. NDMA is preferentially formed by chloramines, and we have actually done formation potential tests with chlorine only. In fact, we've done it on pure wastewater, and we've seen little or no NDMA formation. There are some unique situations where you may, and one of the instances Bill described earlier is if you have a water that already has ammonia in the raw water and you add chlorine, you'll be forming chloramines. But the normal scenario is your formation potential test is done by adding chloramines.
Okay. Our next question, I'm going to direct it to Paul Westerhoff. How do you know if you have wastewater precursors in your water supply?
Okay, thanks. So I think, you know, the biggest thing to keep track of is do you have any upstream wastewater discharges into your water supply, and we don't know as much about the role of, say, septic systems or combined sewer contributions. But again, those are the, you know, knowing your watershed is really critical. You know, here we've used sucralose as a tracer, so you can have sucralose measured in a lab that has LC-MS capabilities. And there's other kind of tracers people have used, whether it's fluorescent whiteners that are in detergents or other things. So one is knowing something about your watershed. But, you know, as Stuart and I have learned on a number of these projects, you know, just as people might develop holding studies for THM formation, it's fairly easy to conduct these NDMA formation potential test where you chloraminate the water and then hold it, quench it, and send it out to a lab. And that'll give you some idea if you're if you have a lot of precursors in your water, even if you're considering, say, switching to chloramine in the future. So these NDMA formation potential tests are very useful.
Thank you, Paul. Another question, and whoever wants to respond, feel free, Bill, Paul, or Stuart. If polymer-derived precursors cannot be removed with AC, activated carbon, what can you do? Anybody? Stuart?
Well, sure. Go ahead, Stuart.
Well, in the different studies that we've done, where plants have a combination of polymer and wastewater-derived precursors, we've seen that they've been able to control things by using chlorine or ozone. I know Bill is doing some work with very high doses of polymer, but at the doses of polymer that plants are routinely using full scale, we've seen when they take the settled water or filtered water and either apply ozone or chlorine, we're getting overall good control of the precursors.
Yeah, this is Paul. Just to add to that a little bit, typically, as a water comes in, utilities might add powder activated carbon first to control, taste and odor issues. And so that will remove some of those wastewater precursors. And then polymers are usually used with coagulation, although you can have PAC in cases with there. So it's really kind of looking at the process train, where is the polymer going in, and then can you add some type of oxidant after you've added the polymer? So you can sequence where you remove different types of precursors by different methods.
Thank you, Paul. Another question. How do your results impact NDMA formation after water leaves the treatment plant? Anybody?
Well, this is Stuart again. What we've seen is that in general, NDMA formation potential is slow, and we didn't show those results in this presentation. So generally, if you've got precursors in the water, you'll see the formation go up over time in the distribution system. The only exception we see to that is there are some plants who have very long contact times within the plant or in reservoirs, finished water reservoirs on site before they distribute the water. And in those cases, they may see more of the formation at the plant. But typically for most plants, you'll see an increase in the distribution system from chloramines reacting with precursors that are still present.
Good. Bill, Paul, you want to add anything to that? Anyway, I think those are all the questions we have received so far. If you have additional questions, feel free to, you have my email address on the slide and also Stu Krasner, who will be able to give you better answers. Anyway,
if there's time, there are some other questions that showed up on the screen.
It is so funny because maybe I have a problem with my thing. I need to refresh. I cannot see them. So please feel free to...
I'll ask the question. So this question is probably for Bill. Have you looked at hydrogen peroxide in removing NDMA precursors?
No, we haven't. The hydrogen peroxide has been looked at by previous researchers in lab-based studies, and it can be effective, but the question is, under realistic conditions, would it be effective? So they tended to be in sort of the pre-oxidant equivalent of formation potential conditions. So hydrogen peroxide is an oxidant, but it's a weak oxidant, so the short answer is we haven't looked at it. What would I guess would happen? I would guess its performance would be similar to permanganate, as in not very effective.
Okay. Thank you. Oh, now I refreshed my screen, and I see – thank you, Paul, for the additional questions. So the next question, can you comment on alternate polymer that water utilities could consider in lieu of Polydad MAC polymer? Do you recommend NDMA FP tests for such polymers? That's going to be a big answer. There's a whole project on that. But any of you, Stu, you're part of Project 4452. Maybe you can...
Yes, just to briefly answer, Dave Cornwell at EE&T is heading up another project looking at alternative polymers, so I don't want to steal Dave's thunder, but he is looking at some natural polymers that look effective for turbidity removal that aren't a source of NDMA precursors. The only polymer we looked at other than polydadmac and polyamine in our study was polyacrylamide, and that did not result in increasing the precursor loading. And yes, you can actually run NDMA formation potential tests, or one thing that we've done that Bill mentioned, he used a UFC test, uniform formation condition test. Any test that measures formation, you can run on both the water before and after polymer addition. So there'll be more work coming out from Dave's project that go beyond the little bit we did with polyacrylamide.
Yeah, and it's about to be done. Okay, Paul?
This is Paul. Just to add on to that, as we shared, there's a difference in the amount of NDMA that forms if you do that type of testing, NDMA formation potential just on the polymer, compared to if you actually do it under slightly more realistic condition, that is in a surface water in the presence of say, alum or ferrochloride, because those metal salts do improve the overall polymer removal, and you do get less NDMA formation potential in the presence of natural water and coagulants compared to, say, deionized water alone. So if you're going to do those testing, you should probably do it in at least the more relevant matrix.
Paul, thank you, Stuart. Another question is that, have you looked at the influence of implant recycling of NDMA formation potential? Implant recycling, suppose it's backwash. Nobody's jumping in?
We've done a little bit of work in my own utility, but not part of the study. But as you'd expect, there should be some polymer residual in the backwash water. And depending on how the water is treated before it's recycled, it could be contributing precursors back to the head of the plant.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. I think that's all what I see. Questions?
We did have one other comment. It said, thank you from Albuquerque. So that must mean Walt White is still alive.
That's good. Anyway, thanks a lot. I think that was a great presentation, full of great information. Before you hang up, remember to answer the short question, because we really need your feedback to improve. We want to know, how do you want this webcast to go? I want to thank Bill, Paul, and Stuart for the presentation and for answering these questions. And then I'll thank the audience for spending 90 minutes learning about NDMA formation control. Thanks so much. And until next time, have a wonderful day. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.